This is a valley in northeastern Tennessee in the year 1917.
I'm just trying not to.
This house works for me.
How can you tell?
My overall thinking, my thought process of life, compared to how it used to be. My thought process of others. For me, what a principled life should look like.
Recovery, maybe. But
the biggest thing is structure. What we were talking about, hopeful. I feel, for me, the very foundation of building what hopeful looks like.
Like it.
What's the longest y'all have had clean before this? Like since you wanted.
Never. Since the age of 12.
I've not been sober since I was 8 years old. Till I started this program.
Well, I didn't know nothing about no recovery where I'm from. So being here is new to me. Yeah. I like it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you like?
The fellowship, just the people in general. They care about more than just what they can take from you. They want to help you.
When I come to recovery, I went through Mag Ridge, of course, and I got in here. Y'all give me hope and structure, you know. I never had in my life, ever. And the people that I come into, the group of guys I come into, they was all welcoming. And everybody was always nice and was going to help me, man. That's why I've stayed. What I'm hoping in like 5-6 years, you know, have my own place, have my own garage, to help people out, man, and to watch a fellowship grow about myself, man. You know, and be more open to the community and helping people. Because I never was that guy before I got in recovery.
I'd just like to be able to become a productive member of society instead of a nuisance.
What do you value in life?
My peace of mind and my relationships that I got back. It obviously wasn't rehab.
What was it?
I couldn't get a glass of milk. Yeah. I was laying in Mag and it was like 2 a.m. and I got up and it was one of those like you sleep hard enough to where you kind of forget where you're at. And I got up to get a glass of milk and everything, accumulation of 35 years, it all boiled down to I couldn't get a glass of milk at 2 a.m. at 37.
Since you started getting high, what's the longest you've ever been sober?
If I'm being honest now.
What do you think about living here?
What do I think about it? I think it's an amazing opportunity. Unlimited resources. I mean, if you need whatever you need help with, there's something or someone that can put you in touch with someone or some entity that can help. The structure is, it's what I needed. I don't have to focus more on what other people are doing. I can focus more on what I'm doing. It gave me more of an opportunity to look at what I want and how do I do that. One word, surreal. Coming to recovery resources, I mean it. I didn't see myself getting back into a sober living. I hadn't really made a good name for myself. I know that, you know, it wasn't like, you know, he's back. Like, we'd love to have him. Like, I don't think it was that way. So to still be here is surreal.
I'm just gonna pretend like I'm talking to you, Raj. How's that?
God, I'm So recovery resources to me is kind of ever evolving. When it first started, it seemed like just kind of a way to be of service with a name. You know, like I wanted to be of service. I felt very young in recovery. I still do, but much younger. And so I thought, how cool would it be to be able to be of service and have a name that people know? And so I think some of it honestly was that, like, these people want me to help them do something, and I believe I'm capable of doing it, so let's do it. And in the last 3 years, I've just watched it evolve into somewhat of a machine. Like, I imagine a transformer, right? So it starts as one thing, and then we get this need. Somebody calls us with this need, and we just transform into this other thing. And so we're now doing housing, which, you know, we talked about 3.5 years ago. And I honestly believed we could do it. I just didn't know that it would fall into place like it has. Today, recovery resources for me is a labor of love. A lot of blood, sweat, and tears. And it's really cool to get to do it with y'all. And the support and the love that we've gotten from the people in the community has been overwhelming. Like, people have shown up and shown out in a way that's shocking to me still. I mean, to me, it's like living and breathing, right? So it's, and I didn't see it that way in the beginning, I'll be honest, because I'm a pretty rigid person. Like, we put everything in a box, and if it doesn't fit in the box, then we throw it away. We keep the box. That's kind of the way my life has been. And so Recovery Resources has been extraordinary in teaching me that there is no box. I mean, that we show up for the need, and the need is ever-changing and growing. And so we get to be malleable. We get to be nimble. We get to be ever-changing and ever-moving, and that keeps it exciting and exhausting, because we have to be ready to, you know. Right now, the need's housing. We know there's a need for transportation, and we haven't found a way to meet that yet. Who knows what the need will be in a year? It's changed my recovery. The way I show up for people, the way I view recovery, the box that I tried to put recovery in, I've really been able to kind of break that box down, and I'm not sure I would have gotten there had I not walked through this.
Recovery career, this has been a
part of it.
Part of it as well, just as much.
Yeah, because I was under a year when we started. And so, which was also part of the, I guess, the luster of asking to be involved in, or you all asking me to be involved in something like this. Like, you all just have this bright idea and you're like, hey, help us with it. And I've got less than a year sober, like, thinking, how do you even know I'm gonna make it a year? And so, you know, being involved in something like this has certainly propelled my recovery. Doing something that I love and value and consider so worthwhile, it's part of that connection that I have to have for recovery. If I'm not connected to something, someone, some being, I'm not gonna stay sober. And Recovery Resources has definitely given me that. You know, in the beginning it was y'all. It was just y'all. For me, it's like that level of loving on people. Like, letting people know that they're loved precisely where they are, what they're doing, how they are in that moment. And there's this part of me that believes if I do that well enough, then they'll carry that with them.
Like,
is it bad?
I don't know. I'm just cautionary.
It has so many avenues in my life. Like, if I had to boil it down to a word, it's like my child. It's something that I put my heart and soul into. It's something that I believe in. It's something that I hope is going to be here after I die. It started as just a relationship I had with you, a relationship I had with Tabitha. And so it went from just a concept to, the stages of infancy. And now it's like trying to raise like a 2-year-old or a 3-year-old. Here's the thing, I'm not looking for freedom. I've got freedom. It's not really like, let me get this or get that. It's...
Why does recovery resources exist?
I've never had anybody in life, other than some folks in recovery, who have challenged me and pushed me continuously to be a better version of myself tomorrow than I was today. And I hope, and I believe a lot of times, that we do that at Recovery Resources. But they can get to the place where I'm at today where I'm like, I can do anything I put my mind to. I mean, we're here to trailblaze. Every action that we should be taking should be in the back of our minds, how am I going to make the guy coming up behind me's life easier? I'll fight the fights. I'll deal with the nonsense here so that when you've got to go through it, you're going to have less resistance. And I want to do that for every one of our guys. When they're coming up and when they're having to face the challenges of life and recovery, you can't put that stuff into words. But and I remember being able to cry because someone else hurt. I don't know in my entire life that I'd ever done that. And I say that to you now, and it's like, those words don't, they have no way of conveying what it was for me to feel human. Because it's almost like you feel alien. And when it's like, I can't experience joy for anyone else. I can experience joy for me because I'm selfish. I can't experience heartbreak or sadness, loss for anyone else. And I was 3 years clean, 2.5, 3 years clean, before I could ever feel an emotion for someone else. If I do these things, it's going to be easier for such and such. Some kid that's going to live in our house in 20 years. It's probably never even got high yet. Might not even be born yet. And he's like a principled way of life. You boil it all down. In this moment, am I doing right by whoever's across from me? You got to pour good in.
Cold is the water. It freezes your already cold mind. Already cold, cold mind. And death is at your doorstep, and it will steal your innocence, but it will not steal your substance. But you are not alone in this, and you are not alone in this. As brothers we will stand and we'll hold your hand. Hold your hand. Your baby child, the one to whom you gave life. And you have your choices, and these are what make man great, his ladder to the stars. You are not alone in this, and you are not alone in this. As brothers we will stand hand and we'll hold your hand. Hold your hand.
I would like to thank everybody at Recovery Resources. You guys are awesome.
This is this house. You guys, the whole concept, the goals. I don't think I could go through the rest of my life and not support what's happening here.